next, here's Victoria Coren-Mitchell with a programme that likes to commit heresy.
Hello and welcome to Heresy, the show that challenges received wisdom and reverses a dumper truck full of manure up to the back bumper of lazy thinking. With me here to open the sunroof and press the button marked tilt are Mark Steele, Matthew Norman and Bridget Christie. Later on we'll be talking about the twin joys of Bruce Forsyth and customer service. But now, we're going to talk about one of the major figures of the coalition government.
Don't you know that's the sound of the men? They're working on the train. What are the sound of the men? They're working on the train.
Yes, it's Chris Hune, who, along with his ex-wife Vicky Price, went to prison for lying about speeding points. Harsh? Not according to our studio audience, 74% of whom agree with the statement Chris Hune and his ex-wife got what they deserved. But Bridget Christie, come on, Chris Hune incarcerated in a cell with murderers and rapists. Does anyone deserve that, to be locked up with Chris Hune?
Do you know, actually, the thing that offends me most about that was that it cost the British taxpayer so much money for them to basically have a marital disagreement. I think we need a complete overhaul of our judiciary system. Basically, it's either a prison sentence, a fine, or community service. And I think that if we had some really mad judges, really sort of loose cannon judges, or some female judges, and criminals didn't know what they were going to be sentenced to, I think that would work much better. So, for example, Chris Hune should only be allowed to drive for the rest of his life a milk float, right? And I think that if you didn't know what you were going to be sentenced with, but they are going for it. I also think that it should be means test. I don't think we should have to pay for all court cases. So, for example, depending on how rich you are, that's how much. So, say, Chris Hune, because he's rich, so he should have to pay for all of it, whereas somebody like, you know, Fred West, who was a murderer but was very poor,
I feel like we're really getting to grips with the issue of the Hune.
Matthew Norman.
Yes. Chris Hune is one of the significant government figures. He's one of the chief architects of the coalition. Was 8 months a fair sentence?
I thought that sitting next to his former wife in court for 5 minutes was a fair sentence. He should have had immunity after that, because I've never seen two people as miserable in public. The body language. 8 months for that, I mean, he was out in, what, two?
To me,
I don't really believe in locking people up unless they're dangerous. And depending on what you think about his climate change policies, to me, he was one of the outstanding politicians of the coalition. So, I mean, if we're going to be vaguely serious, I think to spend all that time and money on what was basically a glorified traffic offence is just insanity.
What do you think, Mark Steele? Fair to send them to prison for the speeding?
This bloke was part of the Liberal Democrat Party that stood on a programme of scrapping tuition fees and then tripled them and got millions of people to vote for them on the basis that, well, at least it'll keep the Tories out, and then they kept the Tories in and they've made millions of people miserable. In fact, that traffic offence thing is probably the only thing he's done in the last 10 years that he shouldn't be jailed for.
The fine that they went away for, I think it's quite romantic for a married couple to share speeding points, but most annoyingly, my husband doesn't drive, so I can't shift anyone. Would you do it, Matthew? Would you take the wife's speeding?
Would I do it? I have never done it. I'd just like to put that on the record now, because I think that there are worse crimes committed in the name of love than sharing, you know, and yes.
And would you commit those?
Well, I'm a slightly with whoever. Who was the clever chap who said he'd never heard of a crime he couldn't imagine himself committing? One of those French guys. Was it Rousseau? And I think, you know, if he'd been around in the days of Gatso speed cameras, I don't think that would have stretched his imagination, really. So, yeah, of course, it's sharing, you know. Marriage is all about sharing. Basil Fawlty read that on the back of a matchbox once.
But hang on, if it was a romantic gesture, they should have both been going around speeding together. Like, who were that?
Bonnie and Clyde?
That's it, yes. Like, Bonnie and Clyde.
What, Robbie Banks?
In a fast car. You know, oh, yes, that one flashed. Ooh, which one of us? Oh, come on, quick, let's swap. You know, it should. You know, and they should have, like, cans of pop and crisps in the car and, you know, make it sort of like but not this...
It's not Romeo and Juliet, is it? If Shakespeare was here today, he wouldn't think, oh, chuck out Montagues and Capulets and have us sharing the points.
It was an example of people behaving, I thought, quite humanly. It's a classic case of that what a tangled web we weave when we leave our wives for a bisexual press strategist. That was the problem, wasn't it, Mark? Because the people disapproved of his behaviour later. I don't think anyone really thought a married couple, you take two of the points, is in itself terrible.
Nobody cares about that.
Well, but that's what they went to prison for.
And I think his problem was that people by then didn't like him and they didn't like the bitterness.
One of my ambitions is to do 3 months in Ford. I went to see a cat burglar once with a friend in Ford. It was the most magnificent. 3 months, you've got a key to your own room, you get a fantastic... Yeah, because there are thieves in there. You want to keep it... And you had a fantastic... This guy was... He just died recently. He was the king of the cat burglars in the 60s. Right. Charming guy. There was a library there. He caught up on all his reading. He had his own little bit of rose garden. I'd love that 3 months. Just the peace and quiet.
Yeah.
So I think he should pay for that. He should be charged at Savoy rates.
I think the key thing, though, is that people just didn't like the cut of any of their jibs. They didn't like the turncoat Lib Dem politician. Mm. They didn't like him leaving his wife. They didn't like the wife being vengeful. I think people would have happily seen Corina Trimmingham go to prison as well. That's the woman he left his wife, who committed no crime at all. People would have liked to see a lot of them in there, wouldn't you?
Yeah. Send her down, she's innocent.
She hasn't done anything.
Everyone commits crimes, don't they?
Well, speak for yourself, love.
What have you done? Come on, Mark, tell us, what have you done? It's a private place.
No, I don't know. We've all done a little bit of arson, a bit of piracy. We've all done. Who hasn't? Come on.
Have you done any piracy, Bridget?
Well, do you know what? Somebody told me the other day, watch what you say on the radio. And if you do admit to something, make it about somebody else. So my friend, who is the same height as me...
The same height as you?
Yes, yeah, so with the same hair. And, you know, she's also married to the same person. No. I don't, because I'm embarrassed about them.
What's your friend done?
Bigamy person.
Oh, yes. Why can't... They're petty crimes. Nothing big.
I'm going to swivel the spotlight off you. And onto the audience. James Hunt, you agree with the statement Chris Hune and his ex-wife got what they deserved. What do you mean by that?
I guess he'd driven himself out of office.
I mean, right. Do you, and I will give you a pound if you can complete this sentence without a pun in it.
A whole pound?
Do you think that 8 months is the correct sentence for a husband and wife sharing speeding points?
I guess many people have been married for a lot longer and suffered a great deal more.
Are you married yourself?
Not anymore.
I see. Right. Sandra Jones, why was 8 months a fair sentence?
I think he wasted a lot of taxpayers' money. I think the real issue for me is that I don't think that she committed such a terrible crime as him. And he was in a position of trust. In my opinion, he should have got longer.
In a position of trust? He's a cabinet minister.
I think that hers should have been less than his. I'm not sure why they both...
Well, I think it was partly that she didn't cough to it. And that she ran this defence of marital coercion, which I think hadn't been successful since 1923 or something. And that, you know, I met her briefly, and she's a charming person, but I wouldn't fancy my chances of coercing her into doing anything.
Where's Alan Brindley? You think the Hunes got what they deserved. Why was that a fair sentence?
No, I just felt that he was able to manipulate people, and I just wondered how much and for how long he'd been manipulating us as the public.
What if it had been the bloke who lives in your street, Phil Hune? He and his wife had shared the points. They got 8 months. Would you still think it was fair?
other the sentence, for someone who lives in my street, they should have got a lot longer. I don't like the people that live in my street.
Do they listen to Radio 4 anymore?
No.
Well, they don't. You're definitely in the wrong street. I think we should draw that topic to a close. There you have it. Schadenfreude at the sentencing of the Hunes was less to do with the speeding offence than her vengefulness, his adultery and his politics. But in this country, you're not supposed to go to prison for those. Not yet, anyway. Wasn't the disgrace punishment enough and the job loss? Poor Chris Hune. It must have been very painful for him to resign his seat. Still, that's prison for you. We're now going to turn our minds to the matter of British customer service. Think of poor customer service, I usually think of a car showroom. Male salesmen are so patronising and dismissive. I have thought about it. I'm not a moron. I've Googled, I've read industry magazines, and I know exactly what sort of car I want. A red one. An amazing 87% of our studio audience agree with the statement, customer service should be better than it is. Mark Steele, should it?
The humanity of bad customer service is something I think to be cherished. In these days, when there is the anonymity of the call centre, which is so soulless and miserable, and you have to psych yourself up to even getting round to ringing, oh, no, I've got to ring the gas board, I can't face it, 4 hours of Vivaldi, and it's and a million buttons to press, I can't face them, not today, I haven't got the mental energy, even if there's been an explosion, no. I'll just live in the rubble for a couple of months, I can't... And you think, oh, I can't face it. And they go, oh, well, if you could just ask us some security questions, Mr. Steele, if you could just tell us your, if you could just tell us your security code and your password and your special password and your PIN number and your sword code and your account number and your date of birth and your mother's maiden name. And you think, they're bound to say something I can't know. Like, could you just tell us your favourite breed of eagle, Mr. Steele? I will regale you as briefly as I can with a little bit of human interaction recently that I've had that made me think this is marvellous. Because about a year and a half ago, a bloke in the middle of the night crashed into my car outside, which was parked up the road while I was asleep, and in the morning the cops come round and said, a bloke smashed your car up. And about a year later, I start getting these calls. And the first one I got, the bloke said, yes, I'm ringing about the accident that you had a little while ago, Mr. Steele. Now, were you injured in the accident at all? Because if so, you are due compensation. I said, no, I wasn't injured. I wasn't even in the car. He said, well, the thing is, some injuries do come on much later after the accident. And I have had over 120 of these calls. They happen nearly every day. And one day I said, look, mate, I know it's not your fault, but can you please, please write down my response as the following? F off, you effing W. Don't ever ring me back again, you effing B. And to his credit, he said, OK, then, Mr. Steele, I'll call you back in half an hour. To it now, so the worse that customer service has got, the more I enjoy it.
The more you enjoy it. Matthew, you're a restaurant critic. Well, surely in restaurants, customer service has got better over time.
Well, it has, and it's very, very depressing professionally, because it doesn't often make life easier if they're comically horrible to you. There's a very famous Chinese restaurant in West Central London, which is widely regarded as one of the best Chinese restaurants in the country, if not Europe. But they can tend a little towards the brusque. I mean, there used to be the legendary Wong Kee in Wardour Street, where if you asked for an ashtray in the days when you could smoke, it came in the form of a frisbee across the room. You know, and they kind of shouted. It was like dining a la Khmer Rouge. Scream! Finished food! Out! Before it had come sometimes. Because the deal was they charged threepence halfpenny and you don't linger, and they want a big turnover of tables. But this one in Bayswater is slightly more elegant and fantastic food and everything. And one day, got this noodly dish, and there was some kind of hideous, globulous thing on top, some sauce, that, if I can be technical as a restaurant for a moment, a sauce, that clearly wasn't supposed to be there. It was grotesque. I said, I'm really sorry, but, you know, we've been coming here for years, and this is the first time we've done this, but this isn't quite right. I said, there's something wrong with this. He said, what, do you want me to remove it? I said, well, I think that was the gist, really. That's where I was heading. Anyway, he was so rude, this guy, so wonderfully. He made Basil Fawlty look like Uriah Heep. He was... that in the end, I thought, I can't sit here anymore. So I went back to this guy, and I said, listen, I said, far be it from me, you know, but if I were you, I'd think about doing some sort of course, because you've clearly got trouble dealing with people. I think you're the rudest person I've ever met. And he said, I can be much ruder than this. which was magnificent in its way. But you kind of crave it, because these days, certainly in London, occasionally outside London, it's a bit more 70s and crazy. But it's become so professional and slick now that you kind of pray for the lunatic. Occasionally, you just want a reminder of what Britain was like before we got Americanized with the service.
What do you think, Bridget? Should customer service be better than it is?
No. I don't trust friendly people that I don't know. I don't even trust friendly people that I do know. And I really admire rude, bad service. My toilet broke. So this plumber came, and he comes in, and he's like, oh, have you got a permit, you know, that I can, you know, get for us? I said, all right, yeah, because I've paid for that as well. So I gave him my permit. He went out to the van, and he was out there for ages, right? And I said to my husband, do you think he's all right? Shall I... So I looked out of the front bedroom window, and he was sat in his van, peeling an orange. I mean, at least eat a fruit that was quicker. I'm not making this up.
The slowest fruit.
So he's peeling an orange, and he was reading the newspaper, right? And he was reading The Sun. And then he came back in, but he can't say anything to you. You can't... It's so absurd. Like, I couldn't say... Well, I saw you peeling an orange. Like, it's not exactly a, you know...
But this terrible service was a good thing. Why?
Well, because he wasn't as rude, then I would doubt his abilities to fix my toilet. If he was very friendly, I'd think, well, you're obviously... It's a cover for something.
I had a friend, he went in an old-fashioned calf, greasy spoon calf, and blokes come round, pen, you know, notepad, all that. Yes, mate, what do you want? And he said, oh, I'll have bacon, sausage, egg, tomato, beans, and mushroom, please. And the bloke said, you want two fried slices with that? He said, no, thank you. He went, you arsehole. How can you knock that?
That's brilliant. I genuinely quite like the sincerity of it. I think, especially on the high street, imagine having a job in a shop. Shops are disappearing. There's only about three left. Everyone's buying everything on the internet. They're also worried about losing their job. All the money's gone. It's all been sucked up, given to the bankers to spend on yachts. It's terrible. There we are in shops, trying to cobble together a few pence to buy something off a miserable person. I think if they were all there smiling and grinning and going, well, hey, it's brilliant, we're all really happy, it would be genuinely sinister.
Yeah, I agree.
Terrible service is the sincere front of a failing society.
It is. The worst sort of customer service is the happy, friendly sort of have a nice day and all that. And you think, well, that's terrible. You're just being told to say that. I'd rather you just called
me
a name.
And the bad grammar, darling, with these people. The reflexive pronoun, have a lovely day yourselves today and all that.
Do you think that people...
No, I think we should go back to the old, glorious old days when people wouldn't piss on you if you were burning, even if you wanted to buy half their stock. That's what we missed. That was brilliant. That was us, true to ourselves.
Where you're halfway through what you're asking for, they sort of disappear, and you think, they've gone to get the stuff, and they've just gone.
Peel a bleeding orange and read The Sun in a van at the back in the stockroom.
Yeah.
I think that eventually, at some point in the future, humans will be removed from,
This wouldn't be terrible. I mean, when I phone customer service and ask to speak to somebody, all I hear is some sort of droning, monotonous, mechanical voice asking to speak to someone in customer service.
Yeah, but voices should be removed from the process as well. Everything. You shouldn't be able to ask a non-human for something. Stuff should just be in places, in machines. Someone will invent something in the future. Probably me.
Well, you seem to have thought it through. Has anyone on this panel actually had a job in a shop?
I worked in a pub once, and I punched a man in the face.
Did you?
What was that for?
For slapping my bottom.
Really?
Yes.
I love the idea that I would do that. I bet I wouldn't.
I think
I'd probably be flattered. We need to do our last topic. Draw our discussion of British customer service to a close with a resolution to be grateful for the state it's in. When I go clothes shopping, I actually prefer it when a shop assistant ignores me because it allows me to quietly get on with what I'm doing, biting off the security tags and shoving the clothes up my jumper. Now we're going to talk about the long career of Bruce Forsyth.
Darling, you got to let me know. Should I stay or should I go? If you say that you are mine, I'll be here till the end of time. So you got to let me know. Should I stay or should I go?
You should go, say our audience. 63% of them agree it's time for Bruce Forsyth to retire. OK, he's old, but you can't deny that man has a God-given talent for entertainment. He was given it by God himself on the fourth day of creation. Should he retire, Matthew?
Do you know, I find this question so distasteful that I'm very tempted to storm out in a half, because, for one thing, you know, we live in an age when if a football manager loses two games, the phone-ins are flooded with angry supporters saying, sack him, sack him, sack him, you know. Brucey has been there now. I think he was started out in the music halls as Boy Bruce of the Mighty Atom. He's been doing it 73 years now. Give him another 20 years, he might learn how to time a joke. You just don't know. You can't rush these things. You know, he is the television's answer to the Queen, and just as she would never abdicate, I just don't see how he could... I'm not sure he's actually technically allowed to stand aside. He might have people to represent him in the way that Charles or William go to foreign funerals and Commonwealth Games for the Queen. But, you know, it's got to be someone who at least looks like he's genetically related to Bruce Forsyth. And frankly, that leaves us a Lembedopic. And if once you're there, then you think you might as well keep Brucey for another 20 years.
Bruce Forsyth himself has brought this up every year. He says, oh, it's time for me to retire, and waits for a possibly imaginary shout of, no, no, you're only 87, and carries on. Bridget Christie, is it time for Brucey to retire?
No. No, no, no. I think that whatever level of distress he's in or physical, whatever happens to his body or his mind, I think that he should be wheeled in, whether he's on oxygen.
What I think is unfair is that Bruce Forsyth had to...
He should be brought out on Strictly Come Dancing in his coffin.
Just for the Christmas special, or...? He had to wait a long time to get on television in the first place. I mean, he had to wait for it to be invented. Why should he stop now, Mark? Why should Bruce Forsyth retire?
Oh, it's just such a... It's a marvellous link with the past, isn't it? I think it's probably in his own interest as well for him to be there, because every other entertainer of his generation has been arrested under Operation U-turn. And as long as he's on the telly all the time, at least we know where he is. I'm fully with the programme.
Who the hell does he play golf with these days? It must be getting really hard.
Well, that's it. I mean, his wife is 30 years younger than him. He wanted to go out with an older woman, but there weren't any. But I admire his vitality.
Do you know something? For joking a pun, it's easy to sneer, isn't it? He is an astonishing nick for a guy of 85, isn't he? Mm-hmm. I mean, he can't tap dance, but he couldn't tap dance when he was 20, you know. He's in incredible shape. So whether it's the Wilnelia, what's her name, from Puerto Rico, the Miss World, or a regimen of sheep fetuses that are being injected into his bum in a cyst clinic, or whatever it is, you know, he is a fantastic advert for the mature citizen, isn't he?
What you said, Mark, about it reminds you of an older time. I actually was on a TV show that Bruce Forsyth was on a little while ago, which was just chat. No rehearsal, no preparation, nothing. And he was great. He was sparky and funny. What he's terrible at is reading an autocue.
Yeah.
But I think that shows what's wrong with modern television, is they're all too obsessed with preparation and rehearsal and autocues.
Yes. He has a rapport with an audience that very few other people have come close to rivaling.
He should be allowed to be as angry. He should be angrier and grumpier and more doddery.
I was amazed at, for their age, Ian Paisley, 87, he must go into rooms now and go, what did I come in here for?
But we do need older people on television, and if he's all crotchety, I think that just reminds everyone of their favourite crotchety grandfather.
But I don't think he was easy to work with in 1955 at the London Palladium, to be honest.
Let's go to the audience. Rosa Ferguson Lobo. You think it's time Bruce Forsyth retired. Why?
I don't think it's right for someone so orange to be on TV.
He's not... Oh, you look at Strictly Come Dancing and you think Bruce Forsyth is the orange one.
You have to, like, turn down the contrast on your TV whenever he comes on.
But don't you admire that in an octogenarian still spraying himself and dancing out there?
I think it's a bit perverse, really.
What colour would you like him to be? Like a... if he were blue, would blue be all right?
I think, like, an Avatar theme would be great. Yeah.
Well, you're saying you want to see him on television when he is blue.
Should he go for a younger look, maybe a Mohican?
Let's give the microphone to this gentleman here in the front row. What is your name?
Luigi.
Luigi. Yep. Surname, please?
Lacovara.
Lacovara?
Yeah. It's not made up.
German?
No, Italian.
I'm joking. Luigi Lacovara.
Yeah.
You think it's time Bruce Forsyth retired. Why is that?
I just think he's well past his sell-by date. I think he's... It's all that sort of group of comedians and showbiz people that I think have just are going on and on and on, and they've become part of the establishment. It's about time that he moved on and other people took over.
Did you think Bruce Forsyth was funny before?
No.
Do you mind me asking, Mr. Lacovara, say if you do, but... How old are you yourself, approximately?
I'm 63.
Have you retired?
Yes.
Was that voluntary or was it forced on you?
I was a school teacher, so it was 60. I retired at 60.
But don't you think it would be wonderful if there were 85-year-old school teachers?
No. No, definitely not. It was a London school and it was very, very tough.
It'd be brilliant if you had 85-year-old teachers that taught like Brucey, though, like looking at the wrong class. I think going, oh, sorry, where am I? What am I doing? Was it geography?
We do let people we used to hate, we learn to love. And we do venerate, you know, as Alan Bennett said, I think it was in the Guy Burgess play, if only he'd lived... Burgess, he would have been welcomed back as a hero eventually, because all you have to do in England to be is live to 19 and be able to eat a boiled egg, and everyone thinks, you know, you deserve the Nobel Prize. And there is that with Brucey, because we used to loathe him in the 70s, even though he was brilliant at the Generation Game. He was a real hate figure in the 70s.
Was he?
He was.
Everyone sneered at him, and you know, plugging gamely on and coming, you know, even Noel Edmonds is back in fashion. I mean, it can go too far.
There we are. Time to finish the show with a cheer for Bruce Forsyth and a hope he'll be performing for many decades yet. 2 years ago, he was knighted. Many people asked why that hadn't happened earlier in his career, but the truth is, he just wasn't Henry VIII's cup of tea. Thank you very much to my brilliant guests, Mark Steele, Matthew Norman and Bridget Christie. Good night.
Well, that programme was obviously recorded before they found out that Sir Bruce is to play Glastonbury. And you don't get cooler than that. Heresy is written, presented and produced by Victoria Coren-Mitchell and co-produced by Daisy Knight, with additional material by Charlie Skelton and Rob Colley. The series was created by David Baddiel and it's an Avalon production for BBC Radio 4.